Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to West London Alliance Church. My name is Dave DeSmit. It's my privilege to welcome you to the church this morning. We're glad you've decided to come and join us to worship our great God here. If you're a newcomer or a visitor, a great way to connect with our church is through the virtual connection card that's in the seat pocket in front of you. You can pull that out and scan one of the QR codes and send us an email. We'd love to get back to you with more information about some of the ministries that we offer here at the church. Another great way to stay in touch with the church is through our weekly email, which comes out every Wednesday morning. So you can sign up for that via the QR code that's behind me. And every Wednesday morning in your inbox, you'll receive the latest updates of events and ministry happenings here at WLA. So make sure you take advantage of that. We have a few announcements this morning. One, a summer worship night is happening tonight at 5:30 p.m. Feel free to come and bring a picnic dinner. We'll go sit out in the back field, have dinner together at 5:30, and then around 6:30, we'll come back into the sanctuary here for a time of worship. That will be around an hour. We'll wrap up around 7:30. This is our second one that we've done. First one, just had a great time together. Lots of families were there, so bring the whole family for 5:30, dinner together, and then worship at 6:30. And that's happening tonight. Coming up on September 8th, we have a ministry fair, and this is a great opportunity to connect face-to-face with representatives from the various ministries here at WLA. If you are looking to get more involved, this is a great way to connect with some of the ministries here at WLA. So that's going to be happening over in the South Foyer, kind of off to my right there. In between services and after second service, and that's coming up on Sunday, September 8th, just a couple weeks away. We also have an announcement from one of our women's ministries, TLC, this morning. If you're looking to connect with other women over coffee, snacks, Bible study, and prayer, then TLC is the place for you. There's two times that they're meeting, either Monday evening or Wednesday morning, beginning September 9th or 11th, and they'll be studying the book of Ephesians in a new study format that was just released in June. So registration is available now by the QR code on the screen or the link in the Wednesday church email. If you have any questions, please contact Louise, whose email is in the bulletin or on the church website or on the screen behind me. So make sure you take advantage of that great ministry. One other last quick announcement. If you were present for Bubba Wande and Janet's wedding ceremony this past week, can you please go see Pastor Jude after the service just in his office? He requests that you would do that. Thanks in advance. Before our call to worship, let's just spend a few moments sort of in quiet reflection and contemplation as we prepare our hearts to hear from God's word this morning. Father, we thank you that we can gather once again as brothers and sisters in Christ to praise your name, for you are worthy. Lord, by your Spirit, would you open our hearts and our minds to the truth of your word that we'll hear this morning from Psalm 100. Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. We thank you for the grace that's been expressed to us through his sacrifice on the cross. Would we worship you in spirit and in truth here this morning? I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. As you're able, I'll invite you to stand for the call to worship. Not yet. Which this morning is from select verses from Psalm 136. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his steadfast love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, for his steadfast love endures forever. It is he who remembered us in our low estate, for his steadfast love endures forever. And rescued us from our foes, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of heaven, for his steadfast love endures forever. Reminded that it's our loving Heavenly Father who remembered us in our low estate and reached down to us, the grace offered through his Son, Jesus Christ. He's worthy of our praise this morning, so let's sing together to praise his holy name, singing forever.
Here we go.
Saying, give thanks. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise with a mighty hand. With a mighty hand. An outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise forever. Strong. Forever God is with us, forever, forever. And from the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Sing, his love endures forever.
His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever.
Sing that again, his love.
His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever you are faithful, forever you are strong, forever you are with us, forever.
Faithful forever. Let's sing that again together.
Forever you are faithful. forever you are strong, forever you are with us, forever, forever you are faithful, forever you are strong, forever you are with us, forever, forever.
Lift your name because you are mighty. You are worthy of our praise. You are the King of creation. Lord, would our souls praise you here this morning? Would we bless your name? Would we remember the richness of your love? Are you slow to anger,
greatness of your name, the kindness of your heart, for your goodness. For those reasons, we will keep on singing. Thank you, Lord. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. Your reaching love and Your slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forever.
Sing that again. Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. You sing like never before. Oh, my soul. I worship Your holy name. Yes, I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name.
Amen. You may be seated.
I'll ask the kids to come up and join me on the steps for catechism. All right, kids, as we go to our catechism, as we go to our question for today, I actually have a question for you before we start, and I know I often do that, but I have a question for you, and I think it pertains particularly well to the question that we have today. Our question is about prayer, but before we get to it, I want to talk to you about our faith in general. And I hope one of you can answer this question. Now, if you get it wrong, don't feel bad. Or if you don't know the answer, don't feel bad. And if we can't get an answer for you, I'm going to put one of your parents on the spot. So let's see how this goes. If you wanted to find out something about our Christian faith, about what it means to believe God, about what God's salvation is, if you needed to find out something about that, where would you go?
Church.
Now, that's not the answer I was looking for, but I love that answer. At 8 o'clock, the answer I got was church. And I'm like, this guy's a church man. I love it. You can learn about God in church, but I want to think about a situation in which you can't even get to church. Is there somewhere you could go to get answers about what we believe?
The Bible.
The Bible. All right? So the Bible teaches us about our faith. It teaches us about God and how to be saved. And one of the reasons your answer was so good is because we have a church that believes in the Bible and goes to the Bible to learn of God. And so I love that answer too. Now, listen to the question for our catechism today. The question is, what should we pray? We talked about what prayer is, pouring out our hearts to God. We talked about our attitude of prayer, thankfulness and with perseverance and love to God. Now the question is, what should we pray? And listen to the answer. The whole Word of God directs us in what we should pray. And so what's true about prayer is actually true about all of our Christian faith. The Bible tells us all we need to know about godliness and life and salvation. And so we can go to it and it will teach us how to pray. We want to pray for you kids this morning, so congregation, will you join with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for these kids. As we hear your word today, as we hear Psalm 100, we will be encouraged and commanded to praise you with thankfulness. And we want to this morning praise you with thankfulness for these children. We thank you for their families. We thank you for their participation in the life of this church. We are grateful for them. Father God, we ask that you, by your Holy Spirit, would help them, first of all, to understand that your word, your revelation of yourself in Scripture, you have given us in that all that we need for our journey of faith. And I pray you would help them to go to your word and learn from it. Even before that, Father God, we pray for each one of these children that you would save them, that you, through your Spirit, would regenerate them, would give them new spiritual life, that they might put their faith in you and be saved. We pray that you'd go with them as they go to their class, that they would learn of you. We pray that your Spirit would help their teachers and leaders. And we ask you to watch over them today and the rest of this week. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Have a great time in your classes, kids. Let me take this time as the kids make their way out of the sanctuary to remind our congregation and inform any newcomers here that we do not receive tithes and offerings during the course of the service, as many churches do. We do, however, have a small box at the back of the sanctuary so that if you brought those things with you today, you could deposit them there and they will be taken care of. And a reminder to all of those who already do it and maybe perhaps are interested in it, you can give digitally online and you can get information about that on our church website or through the office. We met as elders this weekend for the elders' retreat, and I am so grateful for our elders. God has tremendously blessed this church over the years with godly men, wise men who love Jesus and who love the church and lead it well. And so I was thankful for that. And one of the things that we spoke about and prayed about is how grateful we are all for this congregation, for its faithfulness, for its passion to follow Christ. And so giving is just one of the ways that this congregation demonstrates that. So I want to thank this congregation for their faithfulness in general and in their giving in particular, and give glory to God for that. On occasion, I am the one to lead the congregation for the elders' prayer. This morning is one of those times. I would invite you now to bow your heads and join with me as we go to God in prayer. O Lord, our God, we praise you this morning because you and you alone are God. There is no one like you, so we lift up our prayers to you. We prayerfully ask what the people of Israel sang after you saved them from Egypt. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in glorious deeds, doing wonders? And we prayerfully acknowledge and rejoice in the answer. There is none like you. We praise you, O Lord, our God. We also praise you this morning with the questions prophesied by Isaiah. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of your hand and marked off the heavens with a span and closed the dust of the earth in a measure and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance? Who has measured your spirit? Or what man shows you his counsel? Whom did you consult and who made you understand? Who taught you the path of justice and taught you knowledge and showed you the way of understanding? We praise you, Father God, because the answer to those questions is also no one. There is none like you. And so we praise you, Lord. We pray with the words of your saint from many years ago, who prayed, "For the sake of your name, O Lord, forgive our iniquity, for it is great." O dear Lord, O great and terrible God, we have sinned before you. We have wandered from you. We have not walked in your commands. We have rejected your grace. We have rejected your holy word. We have crucified your beloved Son. We have grieved your Holy Spirit. And we have acted unjustly in all our doings. Lord, the multitude of our sins frightens us. Our sins are more numerous than the sands of the seashore and the stars in the heavens. They are a trouble to us by day and night. Nothing good dwells in our flesh. All that we seek is unrighteousness and sin. We do not know where to go. If we go into ourselves, we find great faults and impure desires. If we go to our neighbors, they have nothing to give us. Nothing helps except you. And so we ask you to forgive us. And we ask you to fortify us against sin. And we ask you to forge in us Christ-likeness. There is none like you. We thank you, Lord, for you are good. We thank you for your love, which is steadfast and endures forever. We thank you for the faithfulness of your love. And we thank you for the gospel in which your love found us, that we might love you. This morning, we pray for our brothers and sisters at Redemption Bible Chapel. We pray that you might bless them. We pray that they might glorify you and that they might proclaim your gospel and that they might do good to others. We join them in thanking you for a great week of Kids Day Camp in which they saw fruitful interactions between volunteers and campers. And we thank you that you use that to build up a sense of community in between generations. On their behalf, we ask you for wisdom, that they might know how to develop and administer their food ministry called The Market, as well as their ESL ministry, that they might be helpful to those in need, that they might share your gospel in wise and winsome and courageous ways. We pray you equip their people for the work of these ministries. We also pray for Danny and Vera Karanji. We pray, Father God, that you would direct them and that you would use them for your glory. Gracious Lord, would you grant them strength and wisdom as they minister to the bodies and the souls of so many people? And we ask you to care for their family, giving them wisdom, bringing healing, and perseverance. Father God, we also pray for our church. We pray that you would increase our desire to share our faith, and that our evangelistic efforts would expand, that you would expand them in our homes, that you would expand them in our work, that you would expand them in our communities. We ask you to do this work in us. We also pray that you would help us to care well for people's physical needs. I especially pray that you would help us to practice hospitality with each others, and beyond that, with outsiders, and that you would help us to care for the lonely among us. We ask all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to invite Marion Cowell up for the public reading of God's Word.
As Pastor Jude already mentioned, our scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 100, a psalm for giving thanks. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, we continue on in our sermon series through the book of Psalms this morning, looking at Psalm 100. Triple digits. I think back to a few years ago when we were on Psalm number one and we looked ahead. And honestly, some people made fun of me. And not that he was particularly making fun of me, but Mags, I thought of you this week. Mags preached early on in the Psalms and he had this joke about how long it would take us to get to 150. And here we are, Lord willing, in a couple summers, we'll get through the Psalms. We're at Psalm 100. Now, one issue I have been hoping to address this summer as we work our way through the Psalms is the idea of logical worship. It's not often you hear those two terms go together. Throughout the Psalms, particularly when the Psalms call us to praise God, as the enthronement Psalms have done, we see an approach that is very logical. The structure of today's psalm is one in which the psalmist gives us a call to worship and then follows up that call with a reason, with a logical reason why we should praise. Now, before we look at that, let me just give you another example from the enthronement psalms. Think back to Psalm 95, verses 1 through 3. The psalmist says, "Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise." So there is an exhortation. There is a command to praise God. And then the psalmist says, "For the Lord is a great God and a great king above all gods." He gives you a logical reason why you should do what he's just commanded. Logic and worship. The psalmist exhorts God's people to praise him and then gives him a logical reason, gives them a logical reason why they should do so. Wait a minute, Pastor Jude, isn't praise and song primarily for those who have a more emotive personality? Isn't singing praises to God more about feelings? And then the doctrine and theology is for the mind and for logic? No, absolutely not. And the Psalms are clear on this. Now, in thinking and in researching this week about logic and praise, I came across an article on the web that I found quite intriguing. The author of that article relayed a story of his coming across a book entitled Logic that was written by Isaac Watts. Now, some of you are like, why is that intriguing? Well, it's intriguing because of who Isaac Watts is. Isaac Watts is a hymn writer, and he had a nickname. He was called the father of English hymnody due to the collection of over 750 hymns that he had written. He wrote psalms in the 1600s and the 1700s, and you know some of his hymns. One of them's Joy to the World. Another one is As I Survey the Wondrous Cross. So here is this artistic type who's written over 750 hymns for the church, and he wrote a book called Logic. Actually, Logic wasn't the full title of his book. Here's the full title. Logic, or the Right Use of Reason in the Inquiry After Truth, with a Variety of Rules to Guard Against Error in the Affairs of Religion and Human Life, as Well as the Sciences. Now get this. This musician, this artsy type, wrote a book on logic that was used as a textbook at Oxford and Cambridge and Harvard and Yale. In fact, Oxford University used it for over 100 years. Arguably the English language's greatest hymn writer, the greatest writer of praise songs, believed and taught on the importance of logic. Here's something he said in his book. He said, "Now the design of logic is to teach us the right use of our reason or intellectual powers and the improvements of them in ourselves and others. This is not only necessary in order to attain any competent knowledges in the sciences or the affairs of learning, but to govern both the greater and meaner actions of life. It is the cultivation of our reason by which we are better enabled to distinguish good from evil, as well as truth from falsehood. And both these are a matter of the highest importance, whether we regard this life or the life to come." And from this, the author of that article on the web summarized what he was teaching about logic, and he said, "Logic is necessary because it cultivates our inner life. Logic helps inform our actions, how we live our life. And logic is needed to know what is true. These three designs of logic that are forwarded by Watts in his book are absolutely fitting and apply to Psalm 100 and many other psalms. The logic of praise cultivates the inner lives of our hearts. And the call to and causes of praise that are given in Psalm 100 have that effect. The logic of praise also informs our action, primarily this morning, the necessity of praising God. And finally, the logic of praise is based on what is true. And what we will see in the psalmist's call in Psalm 100 is that the foundation for the call to praise is what is true about God. And so, brothers and sisters, let us not be surprised at the connection between praise and logic. For true praise is intended to be wholehearted. True praise involves our minds and our wills and our desires and our loves. Our praise is to be what Jonathan Edwards would call a vigorous exercise of our souls, of all of them, of all our faculties of the inner man. And so let's consider Psalm 100, and let's consider its call to praise, and let's consider the cause it gives for us to do so. Point number one, everyone prays his reign. Psalm 100 is a culminating psalm of praise responding to the enthronement psalms. Just as we believe that the book of Psalms was inspired by the Holy Spirit, we should also believe that the order in which the Psalms are given to us is also inspired. Pastor and author David Schrock came to see the arrangement of the Psalms as particularly helpful in his reading of them. He writes this: "To argue for an intentional arrangement of the Psalms does not take away from the personal and devotional nature of each individual psalm. It simply gives a better context to rightly understand them. If anything, it helps us to see each psalm fits into the larger story of Israel's history, which eventually leads us to Jesus Christ. Moreover, stressing the human arrangement of the Psalter does not deny the divine authorship of the Psalms. If anything, it affirms the fact that only because the Spirit of Christ was active to work and inspire each psalm and the whole Psalter that we have such a magnificent book. For all of the literary arrangement found in the Psalms, it is the work of God that enabled men to compose their individual psalms, which God intended to eventually bring together in a book that we have before us." He writes, "In fact, I find the more I consider the work as a whole and see the incredible narrative unity of the Psalter, the more amazed I am at God and the more desirous I am to keep reading and praying the Psalms." I share that quote because I want to now, as we consider Psalm 100, consider it as a summary of the enthronement Psalms. We have had a blessed summer. We've had a blessed summer in the Psalms, considering that the Lord reigns and considering various exhortations to praise Him and worship Him. And I think we need to look at Psalm 100 with the seriousness that it deserves because of where it is in the Psalter, placed after the Psalms of Enthronement as a summary of them. Now, I think Psalm 100 is a culmination of the Enthronement Psalms because they share many ideas. Psalm 100, like Psalm 98, calls the whole world to praise Yahweh. Psalm 100, like Psalm 95, gives a presentation of God's people as the sheep of His pasture. Psalm 100 and Psalm 99 both call upon all people to praise the Lord's name. Both Psalm 100 and Psalm 98 refer to the steadfast love and faithfulness of the Lord. Psalm 100 shares ideas and imagery and theology with the immediately preceding Psalms. Further to that, Psalm 100 presents its call to praise and worship as a call to come before the King. In Israel, the figurative language of a shepherd and his sheep was a clear reference to a king and his people. In Psalm 100, we have mentions of gates and courts, references to a palace of a king, and the palace of the king, his temple, where God sat enthroned in Jerusalem. Finally, there's the admonition in the psalm, and we'll talk more about this in a little while, to serve. And that word serve is associated with the service that is rendered to a sovereign. When the psalmist admonishes the people to serve the Lord with gladness, I believe he is calling the subjects of the divine king to come before him and do the work of praising his royal highness. Now, as we consider Psalm 100 as a summary of the enthronement psalms, as we consider that mantra, the Lord reigns, as we consider the repeated cries that all the earth is to praise God, I think we can make a quick application that reinforces an application we've already made this summer. And that is in regard to the missionary emphasis of the exhortations we see in the enthronement psalms. Psalms that exhort all the earth to make a joyful noise to the Lord. And as I was thinking about this, I wanted to reverently tweak something Paul said. I might take something that Paul said and tweak it this way in regards to the missionary appeal of some of these psalms. How then will they praise Him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in Him in whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? If Psalm 100's call to praise goes out to all the earth, then we should anticipate the need for the gospel to be preached in all the earth, that God the King might save some people who will serve him with gladness and will come into his presence with singing. So let's continue to keep that in mind, that our King is the only true King, and that he alone is King over all the earth, and we are heralds of that King. We are his ambassadors. My second point, praise joyfully, for he is God, verse 1 through 3. We are to praise God, the great King, with joy because he is God. Now, there are three imperatives given in these first two verses. In the ESV, they are given as follows: make a joyful noise, serve, and come into his presence. As such, they make up the first call to worship in Psalm 100. Several commentators translate the opening imperative differently. The ESV says, make a joyful noise. One commentator uses, shout for joy. Another commentator says, shout triumphantly. What's clear in regards to the first imperative is that it includes the idea of shouting. Now, as I thought about this idea of shouting before the sovereign, of shouting before the king, it reminded me of a particular aspect of King Charles's coronation that happened recently. There is a fascinating part of the events of his crowning that I have watched probably a dozen times. What I'm thinking of is the royal salute, in which representatives of the United Kingdom's armed forces salute the king with shouting. Now, the shouting that occurs involves the famous words, three cheers for, and hip hip hooray. Now, you got to understand, growing up, and in fact, really, until I watched the royal salute, I thought the whole three cheers and hip hip hooray thing was pretty lame. Honestly, I remember as a young kid at a birthday party when someone would come, three cheers for, I'd be like, lame. But my mind has totally changed on three cheers for and hip hip hooray. In the video, and I recommend the video to you, you can find it on YouTube, 4,000 troops from all the different UK forces are assembled on the lawn at Buckingham Palace. Front and center are the troops of the royal household in their telltale red uniforms with their high bearskin caps. And when the king and queen appear before them, they are led in three cheers for His Majesty the King and Her Majesty the Queen. And when one of their leaders shouts out, three cheers for His Majesty the King and three cheers for Her Majesty the Queen, 4,000 soldiers shout, hip, hip, hooray. And it's an impressive spectacle. I was moved to tears the first time I watched it. It was powerful, shouting before the sovereign. And yet, even that pageantry falls far short of what Psalm 100 calls for. Because Psalm 100 calls us to shout before the sovereign of the universe, the sovereign of sovereigns, the King of Kings. And it also includes the idea of joy. The royal salute on the lawn of Buckingham Palace had a lot of seriousness in it, and it was moving for its seriousness, but I didn't hear joy in the voices. But we are called in Psalm 100 to shout for joy to the divine King of the whole universe. And so I ask myself, as I have many times this summer, what would it look like at Westland Alliance Church to shout for joy, to shout triumphantly for our King? What would it look like for Westland Alliance to give shouts of joy that are strongly vocal and not necessarily polite or moderated? I'll leave that with you. Psalm 100 also instructs God's people to serve. And serve is a great word here. Serve is a great word here because it conveys two aspects in that instructions. The words or the ideas contained in the word serve pertain to the idea of work and the idea of worship. You see, a servant is someone who works for somebody else. But when a servant serves royalty, one of the senses of their work for the royalty is the ascribing of worth. Common people serve royalty because of their exalted station. In the service, there is the acknowledgement of worship and worth. Further, in Judaism, those for whom worship was work were the priests, and their service was exactly how God was worshiped. And I like this idea of work and Sunday mornings. I'll be honest with you. I like the idea of people coming to church with a workman-like posture. That is, I think the sort of intentionality that going to work entails would be an appropriate way to think about the Sunday gathering. We have some business to conduct with our God. We are going to praise Him. We are going to worship Him. We are going to glorify Him, and we take that responsibility seriously. It doesn't matter if we feel like it. It doesn't matter if it's convenient. We go to work, the work of worshiping God. The people of the sovereign King of the universe show up to serve Him in worship. The last imperative, come into His presence, is also an interesting one. You know, when you talk about coming into someone's presence, you can talk about walking up to them or meeting them. But when you talk about a sovereign, you talk about approaching them. One doesn't just walk up to a king, one approaches a king. And so there's a seriousness to that idea of coming into the presence of a king. But there's also a worshipful aspect. We are called to come into the presence of the King of the universe. Can you imagine if you just happened, by a happenstance, met King Charles somewhere? Like, think really how you would react to that. You know, I would become, I think, very quiet. And if I approached him, I would do so in a measured way, humbly, not making a peep. God calls us to come into His presence with singing. The sovereign of the universe calls us to come into His presence while singing. That's amazing. And so, in light of the fact that the Lord reigns, His people are to raise a shout, they are to roll up their sleeves in order to serve Him in worship, and they are to approach and enter the presence of their sovereign King with singing. And, as I just said, the psalmist also describes the manner in which they bring their praise. The noisy praise of God's people is at its very core joyful. The service that we render God is done with gladness. The worshipers who have come into the presence of God are jubilant. The tone of the praise being instructed here is not hushed whispers and a quiet demeanor. Sometimes that's appropriate, and sometimes Scripture calls us to that. But Psalm 100 calls us to come with joy. Now, having given the call to praise and giving the manner of that praise, the psalmist gets logical. The psalmist gives us a reason, a cause for the praise. Why in the psalmist's mind should God's people praise this way? Why should they raise a shout? Why should they roll up their sleeves to serve Him in worship? Why should they approach and enter the presence of their sovereign with singing? Well, first of all, we should joyfully and exuberantly praise God because He is God. There is no one like Him. There is none other. Only our God is God, and that makes Him worthy of praise. Further to that, the psalmist reminds us that He is our Creator. He made us, and we are His. And these two reasons compel us to praise Him. However, I could see, if those were the only reasons given that we should praise God, I could see someone say, then why should we be joyful? Yes, God is God. Therefore, He's worthy of praise. Yes, God is our Creator. He made me. I owe Him praise. But why should I do it joyfully? Why should I do it jubilantly? Well, the psalmist helps us here. He gives us one more reason why we should praise God joyfully. And this third reason is the special relationship that God has with those who have put their faith in Christ. It speaks of the special relationship God has with those who, through regeneration, have put their faith in Christ and become God's people. The third reason catapults us into the realm of the cheerful and delighted and gleeful praise that Psalm 100 asks for. This metaphor that propels God's people into the realm of joy is, we are his people, the sheep of his pasture. If we consider the most well-known passage portraying God as our shepherd, we must look to Psalm 23. And in that verse, in the verses of that beloved anthem, we see that God, as our shepherd, ensures that we lack nothing. We lack nothing, not what we need. We lack not rest. We lack not life, not guidance, not safety, not provision, not goodness, not mercy. We don't even lack eternal life because the Lord, our shepherd, supplies them all. And brothers and sisters, this is cause for great joy. But then, as we who are new covenant believers, as we who are followers of Christ, come to understand that Jesus himself is our shepherd, that joy factor goes even higher. John 10 says that Jesus is the good shepherd. Hebrews 13 says that Jesus is the great shepherd. 1 Peter 5 says that Jesus is the chief shepherd. But before we got to the New Testament, the Old Testament was preparing us for that. It was preparing us for looking at Christ as our shepherd by giving us types of Christ. Abel was a shepherd, picturing Jesus as the sacrifice shepherd. Jacob was a shepherd, picturing Jesus as the tireless, hardworking shepherd. Joseph was a shepherd, picturing Jesus as the persecuted and exalted shepherd. Moses was a shepherd, picturing Jesus as the redeeming and guiding shepherd. David was a shepherd, picturing Jesus as the shepherd king. When we, brothers and sisters, consider Jesus as our shepherd, as the one who cares for us, provides for us, leads us, guides us, as the one who suffered for us, as the one who died for us, as the one who has been exalted to the right hand of God, who has been enthroned for eternity as the eternal king, we have great cause for joy. The joy that Psalm 100 calls us to express in exuberant praise. We have great cause for that. We joyfully praise God with the logic that the psalmist shares with us. He alone is God. He is our creator. We are his sheep and he is our shepherd. Point number three, praise gratefully for he is good, verse 4 and 5. We are to praise God for the goodness of his royal reign. The last two verses of Psalm 100 mirror the first three. There is a call to praise, the manner of praise is described, and there is a cause for praise given. The call to praise in the second half of Psalm is also threefold. We are given imperatives to enter, to acknowledge, and to bless. We are to enter through gates, and we are to enter into courts. Not only is that a call to worship a king, it's a call to worship God together in community. The importance of our Sunday morning gathering is reinforced by this exhortation in Psalm 100. The idea of church in the New Testament revolves around the idea of gathering. The word church, ecclesia, meant the assembly, the gathering of the people. That's what we do. And we say at West London Alliance Church, we have many important gatherings. We gather in life groups. We gather for men's prayer and for women's prayer. We gather as men's ministries and women's ministries. The youth gather in junior high and senior high. They gather in their Sunday school classes. The worship teams gather. We have a lot of important gatherings, but there is one gathering more important than any other. It's the gathering when the people of God gather on the Lord's Day to worship him as king. And Psalm 100 reinforces that. We are to also give thanks to God. This contains the idea of acknowledgement that we considered last week. We are to publicly affirm the greatness of God. And we can do this on Sunday by the praises that we sing. We can do this by the amens we give at the end of prayers and occasionally during the sermon. Even our hands raised in worship, in many cases, is a public acknowledgement of our gratitude to God. And finally, we are to bless His name. Is there anyone here who is from the southern U.S.? Anyone? I don't see any hands. Well, that gives me a little more freedom than this morning. If you have spent any time in the southern states or in the company of people from the south, you have probably heard the phrase, bless your heart. Southerners use this phrase. They use it sometimes to show empathy and to show pity and compassion, but sometimes they use it to show derision or to show sarcasm, or sometimes they use it to actually hide what they're really thinking. It's a very nebulous expression. If you ever get a bless your heart coming your way, you better be careful till you know what it means. It's not always clear. But to bless God's name is very specific in Scripture. To bless God's name is to publicly praise Him with the intention of elevating and enhancing God's reputation in the minds of people who hear it. We have a song that we'll sing in a few minutes that gets this great. Its lyrics contains the truth of this so well. I know when I am going to quote some lyrics from some song, whether it be an 80s song or a worship song, a lot of you are thinking, is he going to sing it? And you know, I think I probably could nail it if I did. But I'm not going to. Because I think it's helpful to hear the words spoken. We're going to sing this song in a moment. Bless God in the sanctuary. Bless God in the fields of plenty. Bless God in the darkest valley. Every chance I get, I'll bless your name. Bless God when my hands are empty. Bless God with a praise that costs me. Bless God when nobody's watching. Every chance I get, I'll bless your name. Bless God when the weapon's forming. Bless God when the walls are falling. Bless God because He goes before me. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God, for He holds the victory. Bless God, for He's always with me. Bless God, for He's always worthy. Every chance I get, I'll bless your name. Psalm 100 reminds us, in fact, requires us to bless God in every circumstance. And it gives us good reason to do so. And why? In these last two verses of Psalm 100, why? What's the cause? What's the logical reasoning for praising God? Because He is, the reason is because He is good. Because He is good. Praise God, He is good. In Scripture, good usually refers to anything that promotes or enhances or protects or preserves life. Think of God in the early chapters of Genesis, creating everything and saying it is good, because it pertains usually to that which promotes and enhances and protects and preserves life. And so Scripture says, when it says God is good, it says specifically this means that God is the foundation for all the blessings in your life. God is the foundation for all the benefits that life brings your way. Everything enjoyable, everything worthwhile in life comes from Him. And further, we enter into communal praise and give thanks and bless His name because His steadfast love endures forever and His faithfulness to all generations. God's steadfast love refers to His covenantal love. And that is the basis for the good that He does to us and for us. His love is faithful. His covenantal love keeps its promises. His covenantal love fulfills His plans. His covenantal love means He will never, ever fail His people. Now, that covenantal love was originally directed towards the Jewish people. But at the coming of Christ, that changed. And Paul talks about the change in the covenantal love of God from the people of Israel only and exclusively, really, to the all people who will put their faith in Christ. And Paul, in looking at this, says it's a mystery. He calls it a mystery. He calls the covenantal love of God that's been moved from just Israel to all people. He calls it a mystery. In Colossians 2:2, it's God's mystery. In Colossians 4:3, it's the mystery of Christ. And in Ephesians 6:19, it's the mystery of the gospel. In 1 Timothy 3:16, Paul writes, "Great indeed, we confess, is the mystery of godliness. He was manifested in the flesh, vindicated by the Spirit, seen by the angels, and proclaimed by the nations, believed on in the world and taken up into glory." You see, the mystery that Paul was talking about, this mystery of the covenantal love of God being directed only to the Jews and through Christ being directed to all people who will put their faith in him, the mystery is the gospel itself. That's the mystery. That's what Paul was talking about. The covenantal love of God, his promises that will be fulfilled, his plans that cannot be thwarted, is now directed to all people who will put their faith in Christ. When we look at the gospel, we see the good news of the Son of God taking on human nature and taking on human flesh and becoming a man. When we look at the gospel, we see a life lived in perfect obedience to God, an obedience which took Jesus to the cross where he died for the sins of the world. We see a life resurrected from the dead, which was the Spirit's vindication that Jesus had kept all of God's promises and that Jesus had fulfilled all of God's plans. And in the gospel, we see the Son of God, as we've said, ascended and sitting at the right hand of God in glory. First, let me say to those of you who are here who are not believers, the gospel remains a mystery to you. And it doesn't matter how much you think you understand the gospel. If you have not put your faith in Christ, repented of your sins, and entrusted your life to him, the gospel remains a perplexing mystery to you. But if that's you, let me assure you this morning, your perplexity in the gospel can turn into praise in the gospel. And that happens when you repent of your sin and you put your trust in God, and that beautiful gospel is no longer perplexing to you. And God puts in your heart the desire to praise him. Let me encourage you this morning, join the ranks of the redeemed, who are no longer perplexed by the mystery of the gospel, but praise because of the mystery of the gospel. And for all of those who believe, who have put their faith in Christ, see that Psalm 100 is a call to us, to those who have heard and received the gospel, a call to praise the Lord who reigns. A culminating psalm to remind us of the great King of the universe who reigns over everything. And all the entailments of that we've talked about this summer, Psalm 100 calls us to praise. To praise him because he's God and to praise him because he's good. And so to finish this morning, let me read Colossians 3:15-17, which has this idea of a call to praise and a cause for praise, which describes our mean and manner of how we praise as we gather together as God's people. Colossians 3:15-17. "And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again this morning for your word. We thank you for all of the men whom the Holy Spirit inspired to read the Psalms, and we thank you for ordering the Psalms the way you did, that we may go to them and learn of you. I pray that you, by your Spirit, would help each one of us to continue to acknowledge the Lord reigns, to continue to investigate and dwell and meditate on what that means for us who have been saved by the great King Jesus. And I pray that you would help us increasingly to be people who praise you with cause, who praise you because you are good, who praise you because you are God, who praise you because we are your sheep and you are our shepherd. Help us with this, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'll invite you to stand as you're able, and we'll sing with joy the words that Pastor Jude just quoted in his sermon.
Bless God, for He's always with me. worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Cause He hung up on that cross, then He rose up from that grave. My God still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Say, we were the beggars.
We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
We'll sing that again.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven. Redeemed by His grace, let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Praise God. There is joy in the house of the Lord today. Our benediction is from Psalm 100. It is responsive, and there will be slides. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
We will serve the Lord with gladness. We will come into His presence with singing.
Know that the Lord, He is God. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name.
We will, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations.
Praise God from whom all...